Warning, the following program may contain material suitable only for adult audiences.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another edition of Set It Off. My name's Sandman, and I'm going to be your host for the next 30 minutes. Thanks for listening, everybody. Since I've only got 30 minutes on the show, I'm going to jump right in and dispense with any pleasantries that I may normally do. And I'm going to get right into the topic of the show, which is Super Bowl conspiracy theories. There was, in case you missed it, in case you weren't one of the 20 billion or however many people they had watching the game on Sunday night, there was a power outage during the third quarter, I believe it was. And there are loads of people out there who have all of these conspiracy theories related to the power outage and what caused it and why. And when I heard on TV today that there were these people who are having all these conspiracy theories and everything, I could not let that go by without me poking fun at it. Now, if you listen any at all to my flagship show, Parareality Radio, you'll know that I do not subscribe to a lot of conspiracy theories, very few as a matter of fact. And for those of you who don't know what Parareality Radio is, it is my flagship show. It's a coast-to-coast AM type spinoff show, type show. It's it deals with all things paranormal, mysterious, strange, unsolved, things like that. And from time to time, I do bring up some conspiracy theories. And I'm not a big believer in a lot of conspiracy theories out there. But when I heard that there were people who were having all of these conspiracy theories go on about the Super Bowl, I just could not, in good conscience, let that go without me making some sort of commentary on it. And since it really kind of doesn't fit into anything else but Set It Off here, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to talk about the Super Bowl conspiracy theories. Now, by the time this show airs, it will be later in the month of February. I'm pre-recording this show. This show is actually being recorded on the 5th of February, which is a couple of days after the Super Bowl, but it's not scheduled to air until like the 25th of February. So, you know, some of this stuff I'm talking about may be a little dated by then, but I'm still going to freaking talk about it. And that is the topic of this show. Power outage conspiracy theories really have taken center stage in Super Bowl 47. Not the fact that it was the Harbaugh brothers, you know, versus each other, or that the Ravens won. It's really what you're hearing about over these last couple of days are the power outage and the conspiracy theories around this power outage. So, like I said, in case you missed it or have been hiding under a rock or whatever, there's a power outage that appeared to alter the course of Super Bowl 47 when the 49ers rallied against the Ravens. But was this power outage an accident? Could it have been a cunning plan by the broadcaster? Maybe it was divine intervention, or maybe it was even caused by Beyonce. Super Bowl 47 was setting up to be one of the dullest Super Bowls in recent history, which, if you ask me, they all are pretty much dull. I like to watch football. I'm a college ball fan more so than pro, but I do like to watch pro. You always had this big hype going up into the Super Bowl, and the game itself always seems like such a letdown. And this was setting up to be another dull game. You know, one of the dullest in recent history, kind of a nostalgic throwback to the days when the Dallas Cowboys would routinely dismantle the Buffalo Bills when something unexpected happened. Down 28-6 to the Baltimore Ravens, the San Francisco 49ers quarterback Colin Kaepernick had just taken a sack when the lights went off in the Mercedes-Benz Superdome. A mere 34 minutes later, although it must have seemed like centuries for the TV analyst filling in the interim there, the power miraculously came back on. And with it returned the San Francisco 49ers offense. After scoring only two field goals prior to the power failure, the 49ers scored 17 unanswered points and looked poised to pull off the biggest comeback in Super Bowl history. Suddenly, the media had its narrative there. The 49ers had the momentum, and it was all thanks to the power outage. Unfortunately, for those already writing their stories in their heads and for those rooting for San Francisco, as well as one supposes, the blackout inspires miraculous 49er comeback headlines were not to be. Down just 34-29 with less than 2 minutes remaining, the 49ers were in a first and goal situation but were unable to score the necessary touchdown. In the end, the Ravens defeated the 49ers 34-31. The 49ers tacking on a meaningless to all but the gamblers, I guess, safety to account for the final score, leaving San Francisco fans obviously disappointed. Now, even had the San Francisco 49ers won Super Bowl 47, the idea that the blackout was a direct cause of their second half success seems to be a little ridiculous, if you ask me. The power outage was not the reason that Ravens running back Ray Rice fumbled the ball during a pretty promising third quarter drive. It wasn't some nebulous blackout-related momentum that caused the Ravens to be called have a penalty called against them on a missed field goal kick by San Francisco's David Akers, giving Akers second chance for a successful do-over. The fact that the 49ers played better could simply be because they made adjustments during halftime. They began their comeback on what was only their second possession of the second half. Or even just the mere regression to the mean. Simply put, the second half was likely to go different than the first because the 49ers were too good to be held to field goals for the entire game. Whether or not the power outage had a concrete effect on the playing field, it was still the most memorable event of the whole entire game, if you ask me. So then, why exactly did the lights go out? You have to ask that question, right? The initial statement from the officials said that an abnormality in the power systems triggered an automatic shutdown, an explanation which makes perfectly good sense. But really, it says absolutely nothing. Okay, so it was an anomaly. Okay, that makes sense. Lights just don't go out for no reason, and you know, you have to shut them off or something has to happen. Okay, so there was an anomaly. But it really didn't say anything else. So it said absolutely nothing. How was America's biggest televised event of the year delayed for over half an hour by something as mundane as a power failure? How could this just happen? What kind of abnormality could cause such an unprecedented event? Although there are no reports yet that I'm aware of that suggest any foul play. The situation lends itself to inevitable conspiracy theories. Certainly, there is no shortage of potential suspects. Now, I'm going to go over a list of some conspiracy theories that are out there, and there's one or two that I may just throw in there just for giggles, just for shits and grins, right? And if you were watching the game, you would know that it wasn't the whole entire stadium. It was like half of the stadium. So it's not like they couldn't play the game if they didn't want to. I mean, there was light. I thought there was enough light for them to play the game. But apparently, sports officials felt like they needed the lights on in the entire stadium. So, excuse me. Here we go with the list of conspiracy theories for what caused the blackout. Some of these you probably have heard. Some of them you probably haven't, and there's even one or two that I'm just making up and throwing in there just then. I know you haven't heard them. So the first one is rogue 49ers fans. Here's the case for that. Even though I'm pretty skeptical about the idea of blackout-driven momentum, if, let's say you were a 49ers fan, let's say you would have tried something, anything, to change the team's momentum, to change the team's luck. Could 49ers fans facing a large Ravens lead following Jacoby Jones's 108-yard kickoff return, which was absolutely phenomenal. That was the best kickoff return ever that I've ever seen. Could those fans have conspired to start the power outage in order to disrupt Baltimore's momentum or, you know, possibly spark San Francisco? San Francisco residents have been known to resort to revolutionary tactics in the past. Could they have sabotaged the stadium and plunged the Superdome into darkness in some sort of a mad and possibly near-successful attempt to change their team's fortunes? Well, it's a possibility. We're dealing with possibilities and probabilities. Is it possible? Yes, but probably not. Here's the case against that. Did you hear the crowd? It's hard to think of 49ers diehards pulling this off surrounded by Ravens fans, okay? It's hard to think of them pulling it off, period, but especially surrounded by Ravens fans. Also, I'm fairly certain that the San Francisco residents who could afford the Super Bowl ticket prices were not familiar with the layout of the power grid of the Superdome there in New Orleans. Someone would have had to have done some research, you know, pre-planned this thing just in case something happens, had a whole bunch of people in on it with them, and then went ahead and pushed through with that plan, which, once again, possibilities, probabilities. Is it possible? Yes, but probably not. So the next one is something that you probably have heard, is the Beyoncé theory. There is a case, or there is a theory that said Beyoncé's equipment caused the power outage. Now here's the case for this. Because it happened so soon after Beyoncé's halftime show, there's been rumor, there's been a thought that the amount of electricity that went into the show's razzle-dazzle performance with all of its sound and light shows and videos and all this other sorts of stuff had something to do with the resulting power outage. Now, here's the case against it. You would think that Beyoncé would have had enough controversy after her little lip-syncing episode. Also, if Beyoncé's show was at fault, it was the first decent halftime show that we've actually had in years, so she gets a pass. And she's actually put out someone has put out a statement that says Beyoncé definitely did not cause the power outage because she had her own generator. So there, that wipes that out completely. And then the other theory, the third theory, is the anarchist Saints fans. The case for this says that fans in New Orleans are not happy with NFL Commissioner Roger Goodell for suspending several New Orleans Saints players, along with their head coach, Sean Payton, for their alleged roles in the bounty scandal, Bounty Gate, I believe, as it's called. While New Orleans has expressed its dislike for Goodell in less diabolical ways, it would be surprising if some of the more radical citizens decided to humiliate Goodell during the league's, you know, biggest game. Once again, it would have to have had a lot of pre-planning and people with knowledge of the power grid and in the stadium and where to go and what to do. So here's the case against this. New Orleans is still in the process of rebuilding after Hurricane Katrina after all these years. What was it, 2005? So you're talking about, what, 7 or 8 years later? They're still in the process of rebuilding. They had more to lose than to gain by sabotaging the Super Bowl. Plus, did anyone really want to risk the possibility that Goodell would punish the New Orleans Saints by renaming them something dorky like the New Orleans Pelicans or you know, something like that? How embarrassed would it be that to these people if they really planned this and got away with it? How embarrassing would it be if they accidentally set it in motion, the creation for the Los Angeles Saints, you know, for the team to move? That would be horrible. And here's another case. Bane, the Batman supervillain, he's been known to cause chaos at football games, right? Well, here's the case against that. Bane is a fictional creation. He's not real, so he couldn't have caused it. Yeah, and that's the one I just made up, just because I could. So here's another one that CBS actually did it themselves. Here's the case for this. With an extra half hour, CBS can have more airtime to run more ads, which means more money, more revenue. So the case against this, which would make sense, actually, except for the fact that they couldn't do that, and they didn't. The ads they already sold were for predetermined spots in the game, and they weren't to be wasted in a blackout time. The only thing CBS was able to sell during that half hour was the CBS brand. And I think they did an awful job at that. So the Super Bowl ads were already been bought and paid for. Not going to earn any more revenue or anything off of those. So CBS doing it to make more money is stupid. Once again, possibilities and probabilities. Is it possible they could have done it? Well, heck yeah. Probability, though, we're going to say probably not. And finally, we come to the last theory, the higher power or the higher forces theory. The case goes like this. If we are to believe Ravens linebacker Ray Lewis, and who was really more trustworthy in the matters of the soul than him, everything that the Ravens went through this year to get this Super Bowl win was part of God's plan. What could be a greater example of divine intervention than the stadium's electricity shutting down right when everything seemed to be going Baltimore's way? If you've read the book of Job, you know that the powers that be aren't above throwing obstacles in the path of the true believers, be they untimely electricity outages or news items involving deer antler extract. So the case against this, well, do we really want to live in a world where God, the God, actually intervene in sporting events but don't prevent deadly world disasters? Oh, God, it's the freaking telephone's ringing. Right when I'm about to finish this. That's okay. Let it ring. Let it ring. That's what happens whenever you don't plan for stuff like that. So, like I say, do we really want to live in a world where the God actually intervenes in sporting events but don't prevent deadly world disasters? It kind of sounds like a really horrifyingly dark branch of Gnostic theology that none of us could accept without going stark raving mad. Come to think of it, this actually would help to explain a lot about Ray Lewis. However, the power outage, whatever happened to it, however it came about, whether it was a mere accident or part of some larger, more sinister plot, there's no doubt that it was probably about the most memorable part of Super Bowl 47. As ridiculous as these conspiracy theories may sound, it may even be more difficult to believe that the Super Bowl, the most thoroughly planned entertainment event of the year, could have been undone by something as commonplace as an accidental power failure. With all due respect to the Baltimore Ravens, this Super Bowl's legacy will be the moment when the year's most expensive television program was caught looking as unprepared and befuddled as the most low-budgeted local broadcast because of the power outage and what it did to the broadcast. Man, so I don't know if you watch the Super Bowl or not. I only was able to watch, because of my schedule, I was only able to watch the third quarter. And I did get to see the power outage. And by the way, I apologize for the phone ringing. Usually I unplug the phone in the studio whenever I'm about to pre-record a show. And I forgot to do that this time. So there you go. That's what happens. And guess what? I'm not gonna re-record this show because I'm too close to the damn end now. So screw it. You're just gonna have to have a telephone ringing in the background. But I got a few minutes left here, so I need to do some filler time. So I am going to play for you a clip that a fan of the show sent to me. So I just want to warn those of you out there who may be offended by adult material, this is pretty damn adult, and the it is unaltered, unedited, except for the fact that I added in the background music. The background music was not sent with this, so I'm going to let you listen to this now. This was an audio clip emailed to me by a fan of the show. Here we go. So, what'd you think about that? That was pretty sweet, wasn't it? That was sent in to me by a fan of the show who apparently wants me, Sandman, so bad. I like it when people email stuff like that to me. That is absolutely freaking awesome. Totally and completely awesome. I love that. I don't know what to say other than thank you for sending that in to me. And I really want to call out this person's name so bad, but I'm not going to. Let's just say her initials, JB. Thank you, JB, for sending that in to me. That absolutely made my day. I loved it. Send more stuff like that in to me so I can play it on the air. All right, everybody, that does it for this episode of Set It Off. My name's Sandman, and no schedule for the show. I'll just come back the next time that something sets me off. You never know what I'm going to say next. I'm going to leave you with a little bit of the Kuna Coil. This is Kill the Light. We'll see you later, everybody.
inside.